Apple Intelligence has a lot of assistive AI features built into it that can actually be extremely helpful, and I want to kind of dive into what those features are. This video is sponsored by Notion. Now, everything I talk about in this video works on the Mac, the iPhone, and the iPad. By default, Apple Intelligence isn't turned on. You have to go into Settings, Apple Intelligence, and you can turn it on from there. It will then start downloading the models in the background, and we'll send you a notification when everything's ready. Siri got a few new tricks up its sleeve. Now, this isn't the big overhaul we've all been waiting for. That's coming later in 2025. You can now follow up commands. For example, I can ask what the weather is like in New York City, and then ask what are some good places to eat there, or even some places to stay. Siri also handles pauses and corrections a lot better now. For example, I can say, add Diet Coke to my grocery list. Wait, I mean, Dr. Pepper, zero sugar, with cream soda to my grocery list. It will then just add the Dr. Pepper. One of my favorite features about Apple Intelligence is Type to Siri is now enabled by default. Now, this has been an accessibility option for years, but if you were to turn Type to Siri on, it would turn off the voice part of Siri. Now they're both on by default. Double tap the home bar to get Type to Siri. If you have a keyboard attached to your iPad, you can use Globe S. Here you can type any Siri command. I like using this when I'm working at my iPad with a physical keyboard or when I'm out in public and don't want to be yelling at my device. Now, one thing that kind of puzzles me is why Apple made a separate Type to Siri bar and didn't just roll this into Spotlight. Personally, I think this would have been a really incredibly handy feature if this was built right into that Spotlight bar. Just make Spotlight even more robust. It really would have been nice because Spotlight could have handled all your searches, both locally and internet-based, commands, shortcuts, everything just rolled into that bar would have been really nice. In Apple Intelligence, Siri can reach out to ChatGPT for things it can't do on its own. In Settings, you can sign into your ChatGPT account if you have one.
This way, if you have a paid account, you can get access to those extra features and higher request limits.
Now, if you want everything to stay private, just don't sign in. And this is the way it is by default. It doesn't store your conversations. It can't identify you as a person. It's just kind of its own siloed system. In Settings, Apple Intelligence, ChatGPT, you can turn off the feature that basically requires Apple Intelligence to prompt you every single time it's going to go out to ChatGPT. If you don't mind it just constantly going out to it when Siri doesn't have the answer, you can just turn this off. You can also jump straight into ChatGPT by typing Ask ChatGPT and then whatever question you have for it. I set up a keyboard shortcut in Settings, General, Keyboard, Text Replacement. If I type AGPT, it autofills to Ask ChatGPT. I've been using this to ask a bunch of just general questions. A lot of stuff that I would have used Google for in the past. Now, where this is limited is it's not full ChatGPT. It doesn't store your previous conversations, so you can't go back to those and pick up where you left off. Now, this is done for privacy, and I totally don't blame Apple for doing it this way, but it would have been nice to have that kind of option of like, hey, you know, if I wanted to store my conversations completely, do that. Because there's currently no way to follow up to previous chats, and that's kind of a superpower of ChatGPT. There's also no custom GPT support as well. Now, by adding ChatGPT support, what Apple has done with this is it's replaced all those times you've asked Siri a question and it's like, well, I don't know, but I can go out to the web. This is essentially acting as Apple's native search engine now. This video is sponsored by Notion. Notion has launched the new Notion AI. This is powerful AI tools built right into the Notion app. Notion AI has a ton of tools to assist you with your work. This includes a chatbot which uses sources from Claude and ChatGPT-4, so you can ask questions and look up information without having to tab over to your browser. There is also advanced writing tools as well. This includes features to fix spelling and grammar, translate, make text shorter, help with writing code, and more. What I like about these is they're very good, and they don't try and change my style of writing. That is my biggest complaint about AI writing tools, but Notion AI doesn't do that. Notion AI can analyze files and photos, so you can ask it to get a summary of a document or just pull out the key points. This was extremely helpful in dealing with a really large packet of information I got recently. When creating pages, you can have Notion AI generate pages based on a style guide or your feedback. I asked it to create a table for me to do expense tracking in, including a name and how much an item cost. It came back with more options I didn't even think of in the moment, like date of purchase. This works extremely well if you're creating lots of different Notion pages. There's also two connectors in beta, one for Slack and one for Google Drive, and these are built to work specifically with Notion AI. The one for Slack will help you keep up your conversations, and the one for Google Drive will let you know of any updates to any projects you're working on. But my absolute favorite feature of Notion AI is privacy. They don't use any of your documents, text, or information to train Notion AI. Be sure to check out Notion AI today. I'm gonna put some links in the description below so you can go check it out. My thanks to Notion for sponsoring this video. There is a new focus mode built right into the system called Reduce Interruptions. The way this works is as notifications come in, the system looks at them and tries to figure out, is this a priority notification? Is this something I need to let the user know about right away? Or it can wait. For the most part, this does a great job. It knows my girlfriend is an important person in my life, and if she asks me a question, it gets through. But if I get a message from somebody I don't talk to a lot, or if an app is sending me a notification that's just not important, it saves that. It puts that in notification center and does the typical focus do not disturb thing where you can swipe up and see it later, or it'll tell you about it once you turn off the reduce interruption feature. Just like other focus modes, you can go in and set up the allowed or block list. You can set up smart filters, home screens, lock screens, all of that stuff here. For all of your custom focus modes, you can enable the intelligent breakthrough for that as well. This will do the same thing reduce interruptions does. A few times I've gotten some non-important notifications, but for the most part, I would say 95% of the time, this feature is spot on. I use this with my general work focus a lot. This is the focus I have enabled when I'm doing admin tasks, emails, editing, stuff like that. And this will just kind of send the important stuff through, but block everything that would just be distracting to me otherwise. One of the two big features of Apple Intelligence I was really looking forward to was notification summaries. But these have been a huge letdown. For stuff like short messages or short emails from like one-off people, not big threads from like a group of people, it does fine. It kind of gives you the gist, which is what it's supposed to do. But when you get into group threads or messages that have different subject matters or stuff kind of like where information starts shifting a bit, that's where it really falls down. In fact, the other day I got a notification saying that my aunt was in the hospital. She was not. Now, you can turn this feature off completely by going into Settings, Notification, and Summarize Notifications. You can also turn this off on a per-app basis. I turned it off for podcasting apps, social apps, entertainment apps, news stuff, stuff that, like, you're going to get multiple notifications from, but it's going to have different subject matter per notification, and that's where things really tend to get mixed up. I truly believe a summarization of notifications could be incredibly helpful, but the current implementation of it in iOS, iPadOS, and macOS is not it. I really do hope Apple doesn't just abandon this feature because it's gotten some really big negative publicity lately. I hope they just keep tweaking it because I could see this being really useful and I'm still hopeful, but the current implementation is not it. The other feature I was really excited for when Apple Intelligence was announced at WWDC is writing tools. Now, there are a lot of different components to writing tools, but the big aspect I'm really excited for is the built-in advanced spelling and grammar checker. I'm terrible at spelling and proper grammar. If an app uses the Writing Tools API, you will see an Apple Intelligence button in the app. You'll find this in apps like Mail, Notes, and Pages. You can select a bunch of text, then tap this Apple Intelligence button and select Proofread. You will get a bar at the bottom going through all the changes it recommends. You can also revert changes here if you prefer the way you wrote something. For apps that don't have the Writing Tools API in their app, you can select the text you want, then go through the right-click menu and select Writing Tools. This just fixes that text. There's no options to see what changes were made, and I really don't like this. At the very least, I feel it should highlight the changes that it made, so that way I know, hey, what changed in this document? And since I use an app like Obsidian that isn't a true native app, and I highly doubt it's ever going to use the Apple Intelligence native APIs, where I do most of my writing, I can't see the changes that Proofread is making. Now, for the most part, Proofread is really good at fixing spelling and grammar mistakes. A handful of times I preferred something the way I wrote it just because of, you know, it's my style and the way I speak, but it does do a really good job at keeping my tone and isn't rewriting what I wrote. I use this with the Mail app all the time to make sure I'm not sending any spelling or grammar mistakes and that my messages are professional. Writing Tools also has a few options to rewrite your text into different contexts or summarize it. I don't care for these at all. If I'm writing something, I'm specifically writing it that way. I don't want something to completely rewrite what I wrote, whether it's an email or a note or a message or a script or whatever. I can see this being handy for some people, but it is not a feature I will ever personally use. Now, in 18.2, there is a new compose option, and this actually uses ChatGPT to compose text. You can give it a summary of what you want to write, and it will write it out for you. I did test this out for some emails and even some scripts, which I do not like. I do not want AI taking over any aspect of my creative work. But where this feature gets really handy is you can use this compose feature in ChatGPT in the writing tools to format text. So for example, you can select a bunch of text and turn that into a list. You can have it clean up the formatting or even just pull out all the links from it. This is something I could see me using all the time. In fact, I've used it for a couple of things already. I also used this just to kind of see if it would work to take a bunch of items and actually turn it into a grocery list, and it did a great job at that as well.
Now, there are formatting options built right into Apple's native writing tools, but I found that using the Compose and ChatGPT feature just works a lot better.
Notes got a new transcription feature. In iOS 18, Notes gained the ability to record audio, but with Apple Intelligence, Notes will transcribe that audio and summarize it. The summary will be in the thumbnail preview. If you click through, you will see the full transcription of the note. This can be killer for meetings or if you're a student for lectures. Not only is this a full transcription, but it's also searchable. So you can just hit Command F, or you can go into the menu and select Find in Transcription and just search for whatever it is you need. Mail also got a few really nice additions. First, with any email that hits your inbox, the two-line preview is now replaced with a summary. This works okay for the most part. If people, salespeople, fluff their email a lot, it gets tripped up on that quite a bit and the summary can get thrown off. For the most part, I'd say like 90 to 95% of the time, it does give me a proper summary of what the email is about. So I can just triage that email. Like, for example, if I don't want to deal with it, I can just archive it without even going into it. I found this works a lot better if you go into Settings, Apps, Mail, and switch the previews to either 3 or 4 lines. It takes up a little bit more space on the screen, but you get a much better summary. There is now a summarize button when you go into a message. This will give you a more detailed summary than just the notification preview. And I love this. It cuts out all the fluff and lets me decide if I need to spend time dealing with this email. A lot of times this helps me realize this email is a waste of time, so I just delete it and move on. So for me, the way I've been triaging emails is I will look at that notification summary first. And if it's just clearly like a sales email or something I just don't want to deal with, I just delete it right then and there. But if it is something that I think I might need to deal with, I just go into the message, and if it's a long email, I'll hit that summarize button and then go from that summary. In Safari, when using reading mode, there is a new summarization option. I found this works really well with newsletters with different sections about different stuff. This summarized feature gives me an idea about what the whole page is going to be about, and then I can read the newsletter or article if I want. But also sometimes I just come across guides or recipes that are just full of SEO text. This summarized feature does a great job at getting to the core of what I need. So those are my tips for using Apple Intelligence productively. There's a bunch of other features coming to Apple Intelligence in the future, but I want to hear from you. What's your favorite Apple Intelligence feature? Let me know in the comments below. My thanks to Notion for sponsoring this video. If you liked the video, hit the thumbs up button, subscribe if you haven't already, and have a great day.